Thanks for giving me the opportunity to speak here. And like he said, I'm not a graph theorist, I have to confess. And because you will see a lot of many great talks on graph theory, I decided to make my talk as a little excursion to something that has nothing to do with graph theory. But graph theory is related to everything, so you will find something in my talk about graph theory, but I don't see anything. But so my talk is about Selberg, the combinatorics of the Selberg integral. So the Selberg integral is this multiple integral, which was evaluated by Selberg in 1944, 70 years ago. And in my talk, I'm going to give you a combinatorial interpretation of this due to Richard Stanley. And then he expressed this in terms of permutations, and then I'm going to introduce a new object, which is essentially the same as the permutations that Richard Stanley came up with. And then I will show you a connection between Selberg tableau and Young tableau. And finally, I'm going to talk about the Q analog of Selberg integral. And these are things related to the Q analog. Okay, so yes, the Selberg integral is this multiple integral, and it has a nice product formula with these gamma functions. Actually, I gave a talk on this last week at KIAS, and then some of the audience asked me what gamma function is, and actually I didn't really remember the definition, so I wrote that down over here. I just searched it on the Wikipedia today. And basically what you, I want you to just remember that if you have integer inside, then it's just a factorial. So because we are doing counting things, business, so all you need to remember is that when these exponents are like integers, then this is something nice as a factorial. So these are the maybe section that I'm in my talk. So the first one, so combinatorial interpretation due to Richard Stanley. And he showed that that integral can be interpreted as a probability of certain permutation. When you choose a random permutation, then the probability that this permutation has certain properties. But for simplicity, I'm going to consider only the most basic thing, which is this. I'm going to ignore the, I'm going to set alpha equals 1, beta equals 1, and then 2 gamma equals 1, meaning I'm going to only consider I less than j this. So it's basically the Van der Waals determinant, the integral of the absolute value of the Van der Waals integral. But what I'm going to talk about today can be generalized to a general situation where the exponents are integers. So let's consider even more simple thing, just n equals 2 case. Then we have this double integral, and let's see what this means. So it's a basic calculus. So we have 0, 1 over here, and x, y, let's pick a random x and y in this interval. So let's say x is over here, and y is here. And the absolute value of x minus y is the length of this interval. So that means if you pick a random real number between 0 and 1, then the probability that that number lies between x and y is the absolute value of x minus y. So so x minus, what I mean is this is the probability that random, say z in this interval, lies between x and y. Okay. So if you consider this, if you observe this, then you can see that this is in fact the probability that we pick three random numbers x, y, and z, random pick, let's say pick x, y, z from from 0 and 1 randomly. And then we compute the probability that Z lies between X and Y. You can see that this integral is in fact this probability. Okay? But now, because these are completely random, you can just assume that this X, Y, Z, if you list them according to their size, then you can just consider you pick a random permutation of X, Y, Z, and you compute the probability that Z is between X and Y. So in other words, it's the probability that a random permutation of X, Y, Z, if you pick a random permutation, then Z, we have something like Z, XY, or YX, things like that. What is this probability? There are 6 permutations, and there are 2 such permutations, so it's going to be 1 over 3. You can compute this double integral like this. And this idea can be generalized to this arbitrary n, and then finally I can write down the Selberg integral in terms of number of permutations. So it's just ex. Let me just write and then explain over n factorial, where sp of n is a set of permutations of x. We have n copies of x and aij, where I less than j from 1 to n, such that aij lies between so this is, let's say, ith x, this is the jth x, and aij lies between ith x and jth x. Okay. So when n equals 2, we get this situation. You can just say, okay, we can just identify x and y, and then the probability that the random permutation of xxz, if you pick a random permutation, the probability that z lies between the first x and the second x is 1/3. And then that can be generalized to this arbitrary integer n. All right? And you can see this is actually the number of total permutations of this. There are x, n x's, and n choose 2 a's. And then because these x's are all identical, so we have to divide this number by n factorial. So evaluating the Selberg integral is equivalent to enumerating permutation. This is Stanley's combinatorial interpretation of the Selberg integral. So let me give you an example. x a1 2 x a2 3 a1 3 x, this is an element of SP3. We have 3 axes, and for each, if you look at each A, A1, 2 is between first X and the second X. This is between first X and third X, etc. Okay, so we have now a combinatorial interpretation of the Selberg integral. Okay, now let me move on to the second bullet point. Now I'm going to express this permutation in a slightly different way, but it's essentially the same. Let me define Selberg tableau. Selberg tableau is a filling of this staircase. n by n, we have n stairs like this. So it's like staircase like this. With integers 1, 2, 3, dot, dot, dot. In such a way that for, I'm going to call these diagonal cells and others non-diagonal cells. If you look at a non-diagonal cell here, then you look at the diagonal cell in the same row, the diagonal cell in the same column, then we have to have, we must have this condition. This one, the number here is smaller, bigger than this, and smaller than this. So we want to fill this with integers satisfying this condition. So example, so 1, n equals 4, we have 1, 3, 2, 6. So this one, in a non-diagonal cell, this number is bigger than this, smaller than this. This one is bigger than this, smaller than this, bigger than this, smaller than this, etc.
Integers should be distinct.
Yes, they're all distinct. So more precisely, you can say n plus 1, choose 2 if you want. So 1 should be used just once, 2 should be used just once, etc.
The 6n can be changing.
Yeah, some entries can be changed. We only have the condition on non-diagonal cell with the diagonal cells. For the non-diagonal cells themselves, they don't have any relations at all. So you can see this is bigger than this, or they don't really have any conditions. And if you look at this and that, and you see they are really the same. So let me write the permutation corresponding to this. So let me write the positions of 10 letters. And 1, so you find each position here. If it's on the diagonal, then you write x. So we have 1, 4, 7, 10 in the diagonal, so you write x's there. And therefore, non-diagonal entry, here 2, 2 is in the first row and the second, third column. So here we write A, 1, 3. First row, third column. So 3 is in the first and second column. So A, 1, 2, like this. And so here 5 is in the second row and third column, so 2, 3. 6 is in the first and fourth column. 8, second, fourth, 9, third, like this. And this is indeed a very simple one-to-one correspondence, though. Sebok-Tabro is really the permutation having this property. And in fact, this one is very similar to a very well-known object called Young-Tabro. So Young-Tabro is, in fact, a special Sebok-Tabro in which entries are increasing in each row and each column. So Young-Tabro. In Young-Tabro, let me just write entries so increasing along rows and columns. So for instance, this one is not a Young-Tabro because it's not increasing here. But if it's increasing in every row and every column, then it's a Young-Tabro. So how many Young-Tabros are there? I wanted to ask this question. Which is bigger? Which set is bigger, the set of Young-Tabro, the set of Sebok-Tabro? Sebok-Tabro, there are more Sebok-Tabros because Young-Tabro are just a special case of Sebok-Tabro. But there is a very nice relation between the numbers. So actually, this is a theorem by myself and Suho Oh. We show that, let's see, number of Selberg tableau. In fact, we can fix the diagonals. So this is a Selberg tableau with diagonal entries 1, 4, 7, 10. So let's say Selberg tableau with diagonal entries A1, A2, dot, 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 AN. And then we want to compute number of Young tableau with the same diagonal entries A1, AN. We want to compare these two numbers. And what we found is that this number is equal to this times 1 factorial, 2 factorial, n minus 1 factorial. There is a very simple relation between these two objects. Let me give you a couple examples of this theorem, why this is true. So example, let's fix the diagonal entries like 1, 5, 8, 10. Here we are going to compute Selberg tableau, Young tableau over here. So how many Young tableaus are there with diagonal entries like 1, 5, 8, 10? This is a simple question actually. So every elementary school student should be able to do this one. Because 2, 3, 4 should be located in the first row. So it's 2, 3, 4, 6, 7. There is only one Young tableau with these fixed diagonal entries. But what about here? How many Selberg tableaus with these diagonal entries are there? By the same argument, you can see 2, 3, 4 should be in the first row, but they can be permuted in any way. Mm-hmm. So 2, 3, 4 is over here. So we have 3 factorial, 6, 7. So here, this number is 3 factorial, 2 factorial, 1 factorial. This happens to be equal to 1 factorial, 2 factorial, 3 factorial. So from this, you may think that, oh yeah, this is a trivial theorem. Very simple, like this. But this is non-trivial. In this example, it's trivial, but if you fix the diagonal entries a little different way. So let me just use this diagram. So let's compute that when this is 3 and this is 3. Now this must be 2. This must be a 9. And 4 should be here. And 7 should be here. But now 6, 5 and 6 can be here and here. So this number is 2 now. Okay? By the same argument here, it must be 2, it must be 9. But now, the four remaining entries can be placed in any way here. So, there are four factorial ways. This, again, happens to be equal to 1 factorial, 2 factorial, 3 factorial, because this is 24, and this is 24. But now, we don't see any reason why we should have 3 factorial here, 2 factorial, 1 factorial. We don't see any structure there coming, which explains these factors. In fact, our proof is not combinatorial. We showed this by finding generating functions, some kind of exponential generating functions for this and this, and then by comparing the generating functions, we show that this factor appears. And actually, the generating function for this is easy, but this one we used Posnikov's result, which in his paper, he used like a representation theory, things like that. So there is no combinatorial proof of this. Finding a combinatorial proof of this theorem is still open, and that's a problem that I want to solve very much. So that's the relation between Selberg tableau, Selberg integral, and Young tableau. Now I want to talk about the Q analog of what I have showed you. Okay. In fact, because this is a Young tableau are studied very extensively. There are many interesting properties of Young tableau, and There is a natural statistic on Yonge-Tub law, which is called the major index. So let me just consider random Yonge-Tub law. Maybe just 1, 2, 4, 3, 5, and 6. Suppose we have a Yonge-Tub law like this, and descent is an integer I such that we have say i plus 1. I plus 1 is somewhere above I in this diagram, then we call I a descent. So here 3 is a descent because 4 is above 3. I think that's the only descent. Yeah, unfortunately. A major index is in fact the sum of descents. So major index of this is 3, because 3 is the only descent. If there are more descents, you just add a descent, and then that's major index. And what's known is that if you sum for all Yonge-Tub law of staircase shape of size n and q to the major index, then this is equal to some kind of factor, some nice factor in the denominator. This number is not that important. It's a nice factor in the denominator. And in the numerator, we have some kind of symmetric function called the Schur function, q squared qn. So lambda is a partition. So partition is a non-decreasing, weakly decreasing sequence of integers. And so partition looks like this. Let's say 3. This is a partition. 3. We have 3, 4 boxes in the first row, 3 boxes, and 1 box. Usually it's written as like 4, 3, 1. It's a weakly decreasing sequence of integers. And the length, if this is lambda, then the length of lambda is the number of rows, 3. Right. Each number is called a part, or the number of parts. And S lambda, when lambda is a partition, S lambda is a symmetric function, which is a very important object in representation theory and symmetric functions. Anyway, so yeah, I'm not going to define this, but this is a very important thing. Okay, it's important. Symmetric functions. It's called the Schur function. So anyway, so this is a Q analog of the number of Yonge-Tub law, and it has a nice expression in terms of Schur functions. And because we know that Selberg integral, so let me summarize what I have told you. So here we have Selberg integral. And we know that this has something to do with Selberg-Tub law, and this is related to Yonge-Tub law. Okay. And here we consider this Q analog. Q major index of the Q analog. And this is something related to a Schur function. And now Okada and I try to compute this Schur function, the sum of the Schur function. And surprisingly, we obtained Q integral. So let me explain what Q integrals are. So Q integral is basically a generalization of the usual integral. So let me,
So lambda is just decreasing.
Weakly decreasing. They could be 1, 1, something like this. It's going to be 4. We may have integers appearing more than once. So let me tell you a little more on basic calculus. We all know that what this integral means. So if it's y equals f of x, 0, 1, then this means the area of this region. And we can compute this by dividing the interval from 0 to 1 with small pieces. So let's say this is x0, x1, x2, dot, 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 maybe xn. And this is equal to a sum, say, I from 0 to n, or n minus 1, I don't know. So because we can approximate, this is really a calculus course, approximate the area using the rectangles f of xi, and then height and the length of the base, x I minus x I minus 1, plus 1, like that. Now if you take the limit, then we get this integral. This is really calculus. Now, let's pick a number q, a real number between 0 and 1. And let's say this is 1. Let's say q is somewhere here. Then q squared is smaller than q. So q squared is here, q cubed, etc., etc. So basically, you can consider xi q to I. Then it's decreasing. Then the definition of q integral, denoted by dqx, is just this with xi equal to q. So I from 0 to infinity, f of qi, q to the I plus 1, which can be rewritten like 1 minus q, I from 0 infinity, qi, f qi. And you can see if q approaches 1, then we get the usual integral. So this is it's called Q-Jackson integral, and it's a well-known object in analysis. So we have some kind of sum here. Then what I showed with Okada is that this one, if we can evaluate this, and then what we obtained over here is a Q analog of a Q integral, Q Selberg integral here. So if you remember, we have product of xi, xj, dx. But surprisingly, what we obtain is exactly the same thing. We just change dx by dq, which is a little surprising because we didn't expect anything as simple as this. But this can be written as a Q integral like this. And yeah, in fact, I only mentioned this very simple case where we don't have those two factors there. But if we, in the full version of our result, we have a Q integral of this Selberg integral, and that is not the same integrand here, but we have this one is. I guess change it, but the two factors are the same, and these are changed into like a dqx. So yeah, that's a Q analog of the Selberg integral, and in the combinatorial point of view, this Q analog is combinatorially a natural Q analog, but that doesn't seem to appear in the literature before. And yeah, so I want to close my talk by addressing some open problems. The first one is to find a combinatorial proof of the result, the nice result, the simple result between the number of Selberg books and number of Young books. The second one, combinatorial it's also a combinatorial problem. We do not have any Q version of this Selber tableau, so I want to know if, because this relation is very simple, I suspect that there is a nice Q version of that result. So I want to find the Q version of this relation between Selberg tableau and Young tableau. Yeah, and yeah, that's it. I'll stop here. Thank you.